This is the ET5S. It's the twin cylinder version of the ET5. Once again, it was very well packaged. Comes with a few spare O-rings for the piston, the pull rope to start it manually, or you can use the adapter for your cordless drill, and the instructions. This was shipped from China. I was notified when it shipped, and it was in my hand 8 days later. That's very fast, much faster than it was 15 months ago. The ignition system is powered by 3 penlight batteries, and it has 2 spark plug wires coming out of it. If you're going to play with these engines, you need to get some of these sockets. This is 3.5 millimeter. This makes life a lot easier when you have to take off these valve covers or take off the breather panel on the back of this. By virtue of how the Hall Effect sensor works to time the firing for these engines, the Hall Effect sensor causes an engine to fire twice during the 4 cycles. It fires just past top dead center on compression, and it also fires just past top dead center on exhaust. So I really expected they would take advantage of that and this would fire alternately. But surprisingly, this engine fires both cylinders at the same time. And you can see that these rockers are moving exactly the same. We're coming up on top dead center. It fires here. We got the power stroke, and we have the exhaust stroke. You can see the exhaust valve is opening. Then the intake stroke, this intake valve is opening. We're back up on compression. It's getting ready to fire again. I marked the needle valve with a Sharpie, and I checked this position. The instructions indicate this should be about a quarter of a turn open, but as received, it's a little less than that. So we're going to start the engine with the needle valve just as it was received from the factory. You want to remove these valve covers after every major engine run and lubricate all of these pivot points where this push rod comes up in here and the springs and the valves. You want to oil where these push rods exit. And then put the valve covers back on so you don't get any dirt trapped in that oil. And these 2 apparent screws here are actually the axles for the gear in here that contains the cams. So you do not want to remove those. This is actually quite a heavy engine. It's 1.7 kilos or about 3¾ pounds. As far as I can tell, this is all brass and stainless. And I have removed this rear cover plate, or breather. Now we can see the bottom end of the connecting rods share a common journal on the crankshaft, and both pistons are going in and out together. Now the instruction sheet recommends 4 milliliters or 4 cc's of oil in here for splash lubrication. I'm not going to do that. And the main reason is that the bottom of these cylinders are very close to the bottom of this crankcase. And as this connecting rod comes around, it's going to pick up that oil and throw it right into the cylinder, which may seem like a good idea, but the O-rings on these very easily allow oil to bypass them. And it drags the oil right into the combustion chamber. And this thing will smoke like one of those mosquito fogging machines. So I would prefer to just remove this breather plate. It's not a big deal, especially if you have one of those nut drivers. And you can oil the top and bottom end of the connecting rod, get oil up there on the wrist pin, and put a little oil, tip it this way, and put a little oil where the crankshaft goes through. Tip it the other way, do the same thing, and put the breather back on there. The O-rings on the piston themselves get lubricated by the Marvel Mystery Oil that's in the fuel. The Hall Effect sensor is here. It's attached to this brass cover plate for these gears on this side of the engine, and the magnet is in the back of this flywheel. One thing that is not easy to get to lubricate are the gears that are contained inside here. And these flywheels are very close to those brass covers. The only way to lubricate those gears is to occasionally remove the flywheel, both flywheels, and drip some oil in there for those gears. I have removed the flywheel that contains the magnet for the Hall Effect sensor. The Hall Effect sensor is here. With this off, you can tilt the engine up and you can put a little oil in here for these gears. And these gears are what drive the cam that operate the rockers. And once again, I think the manufacturer uses set screws on these flywheels that are way too short. This is a 5 millimeter long, and it has to go in here and then jump the gap between where the threads stop here and to get in here where the flat is milled on this crankshaft. And they persist in putting these at an angle, and that's never a good idea. I would much prefer that these were drilled and tapped straight in from here, and then you'd have good positive contact with the set screw. So I am replacing these with the set screws that are 10 millimeters long. The original 5 millimeter, maybe only 2/3 of this thread has contact, if that. And when I run this in there, very little of it, if any, is going to protrude. And then I can make sure that that is tight. You do not want your flywheels to get loose on the crankshaft. This thing runs pretty good. This carburetor is not exactly adjusted. I have increased the opening on the needle valve, and this is the high-speed needle. Something I never have discussed before is the other side of the carburetor. And this is the low-speed needle. Now, when I was trying to run this before, every time I closed this down, it would kill the engine because this was closed too far. Counterclockwise opens, clockwise closes. So I had this running, and I adjusted this needle valve until this thing will idle. Now it idles pretty nice. Not all of the carburetors have two needle valves, but these do. Again, this is your high speed, and this is now about a quarter of a turn open. It's a little bit further than as received. Inside the carburetor, there are two sets of seats. There's a seat for the high speed needle, and there's a seat for the low speed needle. With the carburetor barrel wide open, we adjust the air-fuel mixture for high speed. And then as we close this, you watch this part of the barrel right there. It'll move in. When I open the barrel, it moves out. So when it moves in, it's bringing that needle closer to its seat. And we adjust that so the engine runs properly at idle. And we open it up again and see how it runs. We readjust the high speed, close this down, and see if we need to make any changes. We do that several times because there is some interaction between those two needles. More so that the high speed affects the idle speed. I'll see if I can demonstrate that. That's too much. When the barrel of the carburetor is closed, If you have this closed off too much, it won't have enough fuel to run. And if you give it too much fuel, it'll be too rich for the amount of air that can go into the engine. You just very gently play with that until you get it to where you like it.